Hello, today will be solving Atkoder regular contest 104 and I will try to explain what I'm doing along the way. On the last contest, which was on Kid Forces, in the middle of the contest my plugin struggled to compile my code, and the first thing I'm doing is turning on screencast in this case, so let's hope that that won't happen today. First two problems are usually just stupid, just write what is in the statement. Well, yeah, so we are given x plus y and x minus y, we should restore x and y. It's guaranteed that the answer exists, so the solution is if we add these two numbers we'll get 2x, then we divide by 2 and get x, and then we can get y in any way imaginable. But for the sake of doing things the same, let's say that it's a minus b divided by 2. If we subtract these two numbers, x cancelled out and we will get 2y. So divide by 2 and get y. In problem B, we have a string of like genome letters, A, G, D, T, C. Two strings are complementary when they have the same length, and the corresponding letters are complementary where A and T are complementary and C and G are complementary. That's actually like how genome works, async. So we are asked, we are given a string of lengths at most 5000, and we are asked to calculate the number of substrings of that string such that we can we can reorder the letters of the string and get complementary to the same substring. Since we can reorder the letters as we want, the only condition we have to satisfy is that like the number of A and T should be the same and the number of C and G should be the same. That's obviously necessary but also sufficient, because we can just match A and T and swap them and we will get two complementary positions. So we have to calculate the number of substrings such that they have the same number of A and T and the same number of C and G. To do that, we'll say that we will maintain two balances. We'll say that for the first balance, A is plus 1 and T is minus 1, so the string is good according to A and T if this balance is 0. We want the number of plus ones to be the same as the number of minus ones. That means the balance is zero. And for the second balance, we will do the same for C and G. So now we will calculate the balances for all prefixes, and like it's easy to see that basically we have calculated the prefix sum for each balance, and to get the sum for some subsegment, we will have to subtract it, subtract the balances. So we want both balances to be zero for substring. That means that actually substring is good if for both its borders, both balances are the same. So actually we will write solution in like linear times some data structure that will store our pairs of balances time, which will be map. So it will be n log n. You can use hash map and get linear solution, but we will use map for simplicity. So the solution goes as follows. We traverse all the prefixes, go just from left to right, maintain two balances, and when we like staying in some prefix, we will regard it as a right border of a segment, and we want to calculate the number of left borders that are good. Left border is good if it it had the same two balances. So we will just store in map for each pair of balances what is the number of prefixes before that had the same like the same pair of balances. So yeah, let's write it. Our balance is x and y. So we recalculate them, add to the answer what was the number of such pair of balances before, and then we increase it by one. And the whole solution works in n log n time. So in problem C, there is an elevator that goes from floor number 1 to floor number 2n, just going up. We will have n people, each person got on the elevator at floor A, I and got off at the floor BI. I guess all the AI and BI should be different, like they should be together, they should be a permutation of two. I think it's written here, but not sure actually. Well, yeah, it makes sense. Like this sentence makes sense only if that's true. So for each person, we calculate like basically the difference between the number of floors he or she goes, and if there are two persons such that there was a moment that both of them were on the elevator at the same time, then these numbers should be the same for them. We are given some of that numbers, but not all of them. Some of them were lost, and we have to say if the information given to us is consistent or not. Okay. Very hard statement. Let's check if so let's draw something. I think the problem is actually easier than reading its statement. So let's look at the floor number one. Some person should get on the elevator here, and he will get off the elevator on some floor, let's say X. All of this time he will be on the elevator. Let's say that X is greater than 2, so 2 is here, and some person should also got on the elevator at this time. The other possibility would be just X equal to 2. So this person got on the elevator. Where should he or she get off the elevator? When? Well, after he got on the elevator, these two people are on the elevator together. So they should have the same length of their journey. So this person actually have to got off the elevator at the floor number X plus one. And actually we can continue this line of reasoning and look at the person that got on the elevator at floor number three. He will get off the elevator to floor number X plus 2 up until we get to the floor X minus 1. This person have to get off the elevator at floor number 2X minus 2. And we have this group of people. So all of them get on the elevator, and then all of them get off the elevator. And basically that's all. They won't affect other people that get on the elevator later because they're not intersecting. So actually all the schedules that are consistent with this rule looks the same. Basically all the floors should be divided in segments of some even length, and on each segment, in the first half, all of the people got on the elevator, and then they got off the elevator in the same order. And we can see that this is necessary and sufficient. So now we have to check if the information that we have is consistent with that. how to do that. It's not actually clear. I think like it might be overkill, but we can calculate some kind of DP. Like as I said earlier, we can like start at the beginning, then like find this first group, and then if this group exists, then for the all like other people that will go on the elevator higher, it doesn't matter what they were doing. So we can do something like this. We can do DP of like length of this, like basically number of people that we have already sorted in this thing. And when we like what should we store here? Well, it's not clear. I want to say that we can store just Boolean here. Like, can we get to the state or not? I'm not sure if it. If it is enough, what are the transitions? We will basically like try all the sizes of the next segment. So if this state is reachable, we'll try all the sizes that are next, and yeah, if we have this like if we fixed the size, we know the length, so we basically know all the pairs that we want to have, and we can like go through all the people we have and see if any of them are good for this particular segment. I actually think that yeah, we should just check if there is no person that clearly contradicts with any of the segments. For example, he like for him, we know that he gone from this floor to this floor. Then basically if we have this segment, then he shouldn't exist, and that's bad. And we also have to check that basically no two people want the same segment. It can happen that for some person we know that he got on the elevator here and then somewhere got off the elevator. And for some other person we know that he got off the elevator here and got on the elevator somewhere before. This pair is also bad because we know that this should be one person. And I think that's enough. Like basically, if we have reached the N, we then we can like restore the DP, so we know how to how to divide our schedule in into segments, and then I want to state that we can match people to segments, because like we have checked all the necessary information. Basically, for each person there is a possible segment, and no segment is the only one for any person. Basically, when we fixed the segments, each person either knows the only segment that is good for him, if we have any information about him, or he's fine with any segment. So we have checked that each person has at least one good segment, and no segment is necessary for two or more people, so the matching should exist. Let's write it. The dumbest implementation of that will work in n cube time, which is fine. I think we can get n squared if like check this carefully, but I don't want to. So we'll just like for each transition, we'll go just through all the people and check if everything's fine. We can start with empty segment, and then we just go and try to do all the transitions. So if DP of I is true, and segment IJ is okay, then DPJ should be true, and then just if we have reached the end, then the answer is yes. Otherwise, the answer is no. And now we have to check if some segment is fine. To do that, I will. Like for each segment, I will calculate how many people want this exact segment in array B. So now I go through all the people. So if this person doesn't want anything, then we just don't do anything for him. If he knows exactly what does he want, we should check if his preference is inside our segment, like at least one of these preferences. Our segment is from 2 times L plus 1 2 times R plus 1 like not included. So So if he doesn't want anything to do with our segment, then it's fine. Otherwise, we have to check if the distance between what he wants is the same as basically the number of people in our segment. And in this case, we say that he actually wants this position. And if it is already occupied, then it's bad. Otherwise, we say that it's occupied. And continue. So now I want now we know one of these numbers, and I want it to be X. So if I actually know Y, then I'll just say that if he actually wants to be in this segment, then his X will be Y minus R minus L. L. Now check if he actually wants to be in this segment. No, that's not bad. That's not good. Okay. We'll have to do it separate ways. Okay. So we know X. If he don't want to be here, then we don't do anything. Otherwise, we have to check that he's actually in the like left part. Otherwise, it's bad. How to do that? So the first one is 2 times L plus 1, and if we add the length also, so this checks if we in the right part, and then we have to return false. Otherwise, do this. And now, like, kind of the same for Y. So if he actually in the left part, this is bad, and then we say that for this y which is in the right part, corresponding x is y minus r minus l, and do this. And if we go through all the people and they are all fine, then this segment is fine. This is too hard. This problem, I'm sure that there should be easier solution. Even succeed in writing my solution. Okay. Let's read it. Let's also test some stuff. Okay, this should be yes, of course. This also should be yes. This should be yes. But this should be no. Kind of works. This is no. And this is yes. Okay. This is not right. Why I'm doing this? It should be like, why I'm doing, what I want to do, I want to translate like from 2 times L plus 1 to L. So it should be X minus equal L plus 1. Like everywhere. Yeah, I had some bad design choices. Like, I think it didn't work on the like this case before. Let's find out. Or maybe it did work for some reason. Okay, let's try something bigger. So it's no, no, but should be yes. Yay. So in problem D, we have two numbers and k, and for each integer between 1 and n, we have to solve this problem, like calculate the number of non-empty multisets such that each element occurs not more than k times and the average of the elements is x. So when we have a problem about average, the first thing you should try to do is to say something like, can I somehow subtract the average from all the numbers and get the average to be zero? Why do we want that? Because average is zero is the same thing as sum is zero, and we don't care about the number of elements we have. And in this problem, like, at least if we can actually try all the x's between 1 and n and solve the problem independently, then we can just, like, instead of using these numbers, we will use them minus x, and now we want the sum to be 0. We will overcount by 1 because we will count empty multiset, but it's fine. We'll just subtract 1 and then. Okay, after that, we have a very basic instance of knapsack problem, but the sums could get pretty high, I think. Like, yeah, we have n different numbers and they are up to n, and we can have k of them. So the sums will be up to n squared times k, and to do transitions we have to I think that we have to try. Well, we will have to try all the numbers and then try how much numbers we take. So that's too much even for one x. So for one x, I now can solve the problem in n cube k squared. And so that complexity will be n to the fourth times k squared, which is very, very, very bad. I have to get rid of two of that of these hundreds. I don't really know what to do. Well, okay, I can, I think I can get rid of, like, trying all the x's independently, because, well, basically when I fix some x, I actually like get some segment of minus x plus 1. To n minus x, I can divide this segment through 0 here, and calculate the knapsack for negative numbers in the left direction and for the positive numbers in the right direction. So thus, like each of these knapsacks, they're actually the same. like we just get the numbers from one to something, and maintain their sums. So the DP will be. Prefix and sum. This is up to n. This is up to like n squared times k, but actually divided by 2. And actually, like it is bounded, like for a given prefix, it is bounded by this prefix time prefix plus 1 divided by 2 over k. And this actually means that the number of states in this whole thing is n to the third times k divided by 6. And to make transitions, I just count how many times I will use the next number. So the overall solution will be n to the third times k to the times k squared divided by 6. And we have 4 seconds. It might run in time. we have to be careful, but it could work. Or maybe I can just optimize 1k. What do transitions look like? I have this layer of DP, and to make transitions, this value here is the sum of this and this and this and this and this. All the distances here are the number x I'm trying to add now. I have to make k transitions, so I can do the prefix sums over distance of x, and this way the complexity will be just n cubed times k divided by 6, which is very fast. Yeah, that works. So I want calculate the layer for zero, because the sum of zeros is zero. I will just multiply the answer by k plus one in the end, because I can have from zero to k zeros in my set, and the sum won't change from that. Also maintain I don't need since our solution is fast now. I don't really care about looking for unreachable states and so on. so we can just try all the reminders, and for fixed reminder we will maintain the sum. So now we will traverse all the sums with this reminder modulo x up to big M. Add the old DP value from here, and if y is at least k plus 1 times x, then we have to subtract the old value like from the position that position that we now have to add k plus 1 x, as we can't do that. Dpxy is some. So we have calculated the dp. Now we will have to print the answer. So for given x, we have negative numbers up to x minus 1 by absolute value, and positive numbers up to n minus 6. So now we will try all the options for which was the sum for each part, and like they should be the same. I should get 0 in the end. For negative numbers, I send up the absolute values in the DP. So the sum of negative part should be the same kind of like times minus 1 as the sum of the positive part. Now don't forget to multiply this by k plus 1 and subtract 1 because we have used the empty set. And it's important to first multiply by k plus 1 and then subtract 1. Because if we get like empty set here but add some zeros to it, it's fine. And get some actual samples, please. Yeah, it looks fine. Interesting. So we have n numbers. Then we will like make a random distribution on these numbers by just taking random one of them uniformly. Then we will do this n times independently, thus getting another sequence of length n. We have to calculate the expected value of the longest increasing subsequence of this sequence modulo some number, and n is up to 6. And these numbers are up to something big for some reason, but it's clear that we can compress them. Well, with n up to 6, it shouldn't be hard to write. Well, I think that this is very easy. why can't just we try everything, calculate the calculate the longest increasing subsequence and print the answer. Why that? Looks like I didn't understand something. Oh, okay. So why this number chosen from the prefix of length I. Even better. Now my solution works not in n to the power of n times something to calculate longest increasing subsequence, but in n factorial. I don't understand something about this problem, right? It shouldn't be just write what is written in the statement. Well, let's write what is written in the statement. I don't understand why it's not true. This is confusing. I wanted to calculate the factorial. Try all the numbers. And calculate the longest increase in subsequence. I still feel like I don't understand something. Oh, now I get it. Okay. Sound good. Okay, so the generation is different. Okay. This is bad. So is number is a random number from the one of the numbers from 1 to AI. Okay. So like the total number of sequences is the product of these numbers. Great. So now I can sing. Sorry for that. Well, N is still small, so I think we can when we will choose numbers to calculate the longest increasing subsequence, we only have to know like the relative order, so we can fix this relative order before. Like the numbers can be equal, but we can say that if the numbers are equal, then they're sorted like from right to left, because we can can't use two equal numbers in strictly increasing sequence. So if we have like for example such array, we will correspond permutation will be like the smallest number is this one, and these two numbers we say that the smaller one is one to the right and this is a bigger one, and I state that like the longest increasing subsequence of this array is the same as in this permutation. So we can try all the n factorial permutations. For each permutation, calculate the longest increasing subsequence in any time. And then we have to calculate what is the probability that we will actually construct this sequence. To do that, we can also, n is really small, so we can, for example, like divide all the numbers that we have. Like basically, we have this like infinite sequence of positive numbers, but we have some borders in it. And for each position, we know that we can use these prefixes. So for each position, we can actually just say that we will use a number from this part or this part or this part. And when we have that, all that is left to do is to check that this is like fine with our permutation. And for the parts that are not clear, like we can say that like what? Let's say that three numbers will be from this part. We have some order on them, so we have to ensure that this is the right order. It's a bit harder because we have equal numbers, so maybe we should do something slightly different. First of all, we don't have to fix the permutation beforehand. We can first like try all of this. And only then for each like equal part we will decide on order and calculate the probability. This is not very convenient. I'm trying to come up with something that is easier to understand. This I can write, but I don't want. Okay, let's write something. I still need this, but let's give it a vector. What I'm going to do. So first I want to compress coordinates, like to form these groups. So I will calculate like the number of ways to choose these values times the length of longest increasing subsequence, and then divide by the numbers. So in first brute force, I want to like for each number, I want to choose in which group it will be. And I will store this information in some array. What array? I want for each group to know what positions are in this group, so I will store mask for each group. I can be in this group if the group is from this number not inclusive up to the next one inclusive, and if this one is already bigger than my bound, then I can't be here. Otherwise, I can, and that means that I'm trying to be in this group, so. It says that I'm here, then do the recursive call, and then I'm not here. Okay, now I want to like construct the corresponding permutation. To do this, I will go through groups in order they are in, and like decide on something. So I actually do the next brute 0 empty vector. And like the number of ways to get this permutation. Now I start to care about that. I have gone through all the groups. That's actually not what I want. I want minus minus here. Then I say, okay, I have this number of ways to get to this permutation. Now I just calculate its longest increasing subsequence and add it to the answer. Otherwise, say, okay, like I have some mask of numbers that I want. Okay, I construct a permutation like by values, so it's better to like have a vector of length n, and also what is the next number I have to put here. So next time. Great. Here nxt should be n. So I have this mask. Let's calculate how many numbers are in my mask. If I have none, then I just call brute of the next group. Otherwise, these numbers, they are all in my group, but look, we can what we can assign equal numbers to them. So I will now try all the ways how many different numbers there will be. Then I will choose these numbers. That's just I know the length of my group, so from how many numbers I choose, I have to choose exactly k different numbers. So this thing should be multiplied by like choose length k. And now I have to take this mask. What are the numbers in my group, and divide it in some submasks, actually in k number of non-zero submasks, to construct this, and we can actually like, say it exactly like this. So I will call another brute force function. It has to know the number p, because it will call this function with p increased by 1 when it finishes the division into submasks. It has to know b. It will like basically set numbers there. It has to know next. It has to know ways, but already like multiplied by this binomial coefficient. And it also has no what the mask we are trying to divide into smaller masks, and what is the number of smaller masks we want. So if we want 0 smaller masks, then this thing should be empty, and we just call brute2 p+1 b next ways, and that's all. Otherwise, cur mask should be non-zero. And we have to choose some submask. Now we want to fill this vector with correct numbers. To do this, we will use some auxiliary function. And do the recursion. And B and next still ways car mask XOR S mask because we have used this K minus one. And as I said, we should go from right to left for equal numbers. So we are going from n minus 1 to 0. And if this number is in our mask, then we put nxt there. And all of this we should take by, I don't know how it's called. By reference, I think. So I have written something, it is very bad. And it doesn't even work. That's too much. Let's not multiply by this here and see how many ways I have counted. It should be more than it really is. 27, that's not at all. But that's 3 to the power of 3. Maybe this doesn't work for some reason. Yeah, it should be AP here. That is more like and yeah, looks like it works. Not very fast, but should be fine. Like, yeah, 6 is a very small number. Works fast, but that was too hard for this problem. Sure. Okay, and the last one. Okay, so in the problem F, we will also build some array again for each position. We have some upper bound. When we have this array, we will construct another array as follows. So we will, for each position, we will look at all the previous positions, find the rightmost one that has the number bigger than our number, and if there is none, we will say it's minus one. So like this number is the index of the rightmost numbers that were greater than us but to the left, basically the rightmost inversion with us to the left of us, or minus one if there is none. And we have to calculate the number of such sequences. Suppose we are given a sequence and want to check if there is an array such that each value is up to its corresponding upper bound. I want to say that for each position, there is a lower bound on what the number it can be, and like we can satisfy all the lower bounds at once. Or maybe that's not true. Well, let's see. What does it say if, like, we know, we know the pi? Like, we have this position I, and pi goes somewhere here. So we know that this number should be this number should be bigger than this one. and also everything in between them should be not bigger. So for each of these numbers we have like kind of arrows, but they can be equal. So this one is strictly bigger than this one, and all of this are not. Well, okay. I thought that, like, if there are no limitations on like this axis, then we can say basically anything before us. But that looks like it's not true. If we have like E, J, and things like this, this cannot be because we know that. Like, because for I, pi is somewhere to the left of j, then it is not bigger than I. Well, then this number on position pi should be obviously bigger than this one, so pj should be this or even somewhere to the right. So yeah, actually we can see that is as like we are going from the right to the left, and for each number we want to find like the next one which is bigger, and we can see that we will get some kind of a tree structure. Like we can say that minus one is the root. And then like, there are some positions that go straight to minus one. We know that this position, like numbers in these positions should be non-decreasing, because otherwise we would get some other edge, not to minus one. So all of these guys, they don't go to minus one. So they actually will look like some subtree with root in this guy. These guys cannot go here because all of them are not bigger than this one. So since they don't want to go to minus one, they should all be subtree with this root. So actually we will draw this tree structure. So if we don't have this axis, then the answer will be like the number of trees such that the parent is to the right, to the left. I think it will be not hard to calculate. But we also have this axis, and this is not great. Okay, so if we have drawn this tree, which is basically one-to-one correspondence to RAP, how can we what numbers should we use in each vertex? In leaves, it makes sense to use ones, right? The numbers should be like should form a heap, because we draw an edge to the parent, which is like the rightmost guy, which has value bigger than in us. We can write one in all leaves. That is good. But like, it's not the only rule that the parent should have bigger number. We also know that let's draw this as a tree. We also know that for each of these guys, this is their parent, so not only this number should be bigger than this, but also all of these guys shouldn't be his parent, so all of them should be not greater than this number. We know that this is the greatest of all in his subtree, so basically all the sons of one vertex should be sorted. Well, I think we can we still can write the smallest possible numbers in all the vertices. How to do that? Well, do it for this subtree first. How? Like recursively, just say that this is independent of everything and just write all the numbers. Then do this for this subtree, but after that, this guy should get the number not less than this guy. And so on. So n is up to 100, and we don't have much time left. I'm not sure if it is a full solution. Maybe I have missed something, but I think we can do DP on segment and the value that we will write in this like this segment will be subtree of this tree, and we will like the smallest number we can write in this vertex is x. How to make transitions? Well, so we have this subtree, and we want to write x here. Everything else should be divided in subsegments. Each of the subsegments will be its own subtree. These numbers should be all smaller than x and also sorted non-decreasing from left to right. But like when we will go to this subtree, we actually want this number to be like how we have constructed it only from this subtree. So we will go here from like left to right. So let's say we have already covered this. Everything is something is wrong with screencasting. Okay, so let's say that we have covered this. What should we know? We should know like this x. We should know what was the last number we put here. And then we will try what are the numbers that we will put here like according to only its subtree. And if it is smaller than this, then we will actually put this number here. And if it is bigger, then we will just put it. So I think that's too much states, right? It's polynomial, but well, what do I need? I do need this left border, this x, this right border, and like this number to make a transition. I will try all these right borders and this number. That's 6th power, and that's not good. Maybe I don't need this. I can just like maintain this like, set of sums and then make a transition like to append the root. I will have to put like, this number plus one there. So I'm storing left, right, what was the last number, and to make transition I will try this bound and what to put here. Okay, this number is obviously up to the length. It's 9th, it's 5th power, but it is divided by many, many things. So it may work if I will be fast. Let's try. DP3 is the value if the segment LR and in root we have x, and DP sons are the number of ways to divide the segment from L to R into some subsegments that are sons, and into the last son we have this number written. All the transitions are done to the right, so if I will go with left border from right to left, I will only make transitions into the parts I have already solved. So I have DP3 plus 1, 1. I also have, like, this is a tree without sons. I also have to try trees with sons. The root in L, the segment is from L plus 1 to R, it has length at least 1, and the value in the last one is up to, I think, minus L, maybe actually strictly, but it should work very fast. Anyways, so the last son had x, so I should put x plus 1 in the root, and I should do it only if x plus 1 should be at most al. Okay, so now I know everything for trees that start in L. Now I will put them, put these values in DP sons. Okay, I can have one son. And now I have to make transitions from each one of them. Yeah, I have put that here. Okay. So I have some sons. X is up to so I will try all the possible options for where this next segment will end, and what was the number written there. It's DP3 from R to R and Y. If it is zero, I don't do anything. and the actual number I have to write will be maximum of x and y if it is bigger than the number I can write in vertex r, then it's bad. Otherwise, dp sans yy should be increased by v times z. I will be surprised if it works. Looks like it works. And yeah, despite its n to the fifth, it should be very fast. I have a runtime error. Yeah, because I shouldn't do this, I should actually bound it by this value. Still runtime. Some was something, I guess, some runtimes. Great. Big variety of vertex. Now it's just two runtimes. Well, the obvious thing to do is this, and let's look closely. We have 10 minutes, so it's only one screen of code. This is fine because we have this. Yeah, this is also not good. Should be this. Well, I'm sure I have something very, very hard for C and for E also, but for F it looks like a fine solution. I think that it can be done better, but I think I have followed like the essence of the problem, like these trees and setting numbers in them that are minimal. So yeah, maybe it can be better. Like the only place where we have the fifth power is here, and it looks like it can be done better. Like if y is smaller than x, then we will go like this will be x, and we can just take the prefix sum. And if y is bigger than x, then this will be y, and we can take prefix sum of prefix sums of that. So yeah, that should give the fourth power. But the fifth power is fine. Like it works very fast. It's like 2 seconds, I think, time limit, so it's almost 10 times faster than time limit. And the only thing I did carefully is just not very carefully, but traverse the parameters, only such parameters that can have non-zero values in them. And yeah, that's fast enough. Thanks for watching.